Class, and welcome to your next video on water. Make sure you continue to take great notes on this, especially paying attention to any of the figures and diagrams, and you may want to copy some of these into your notes as well. So let's go ahead and get started. You may know water. Water is that plain substance that you drink. It's the clear substance. But what actually is water? Well, it's made of two hydrogens and one oxygen atom. And what happens is the hydrogen is held to the oxygen by that covalent bond. Remember, we talked about covalent bonds a little earlier. And we have a chemical formula for it to be H2O. Now, since it has a covalent bond, we share electrons between the hydrogens and the oxygens. And sometimes we can get it to become polarized. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about those bonds. So not only do we have the covalent bond in between the oxygen and the hydrogen, but we also have a hydrogen bond between hydrogens and oxygens on different water molecules. So they're formed between a highly electronegative atom of a polar molecule and a hydrogen. So basically what we're saying there is we have polarized the molecule. And how that happens is, remember, your electrons are negatively charged. Well, when we're sharing, oxygen tends to get the electrons more than the hydrogen. So we have a partial negative on the oxygen and a partial positive on the hydrogen. And so it becomes highly electronegative based on this. And what happens is then the hydrogen will then bond to an oxygen of a separate water molecule, creating a very tight bond. So, what is a hydrogen bond? Well, that in itself is a hydrogen bond, but one hydrogen bond is very weak. But when you get lots and lots of them together, they become very strong. Think about when you put drops of water onto a penny. The more you get, the better it stays on until you just have so many that they can't hold on anymore. This is kind of how hydrogen bonds work. So we have different properties of water, and I'm going to explain this first one. Water is a universal solvent. What that means is many things can dissolve into water. This is because it's polar. Remember, you have that partial positive and partial negative being on the oxygen, positive being on the hydrogen. And so what happens is water can dissolve more substances than any other liquid. This is due to the polarity. Water will break salts into their initial ions, and this will be called dissociation. So a salt, remember, is not necessarily NaCl. It can be potassium chloride, it can be NaCl, but it is created by those two groups. And so we have a metal and we have a halogen that's going to make these. Now, it's going to break them up into their original ions. So in sodium chloride, we have a positive sodium ion and a negative chloride ion that we are using. And we're going to call this dissociation when we're actually breaking apart these salts. Now, this property of water allows for transport of vital nutrients to plants and animals. A drop of rainwater falling through the air dissolves atmospheric gases. So not necessarily is it just going to be solids. It can dissolve other things as well. When rain reaches Earth, it affects the quality of land, lakes, and rivers. If you've heard of dissolved oxygen, that water is absorbing that oxygen and it's dissolving it, and then when it gets to a pond, a lake, a river, the fish can then get that oxygen out of the water instead of having to breathe on air like we do. So the next one is water is sticky, and this is actually two different properties. But water molecules bond to each other using the power of hydrogen bonds. Remember, one bond is very weak, but when you get multiples of these, it's very strong. So we call this cohesion. It's going to stick to itself. Cohesion is actually the act of sticking to itself. So make sure you write that down. Cohesion, the act of sticking to itself. So water molecules at the surface have much greater attraction for each other than for molecules in the air. This cohesiveness creates a high surface tension at the surface of the water. So surface tension, though, I want you to write this in your notes as well, is the bonding of those molecules using the hydrogen bonds and the power of cohesion to create kind of like a film on top. So you see that water strider in the picture? Well, that water strider is able to walk on the water because it's not breaking the bonds in between the hydrogens and oxygens, those hydrogen bonds. So we're creating a tension that allows things to float on top. This is how you see leaves at the top, lily pads. This film of these bonds make it easier for things to stay on top. Okay, so we talked about cohesion, and remember, cohesion is water's ability to bond to itself. Well, water can also bond to other things. We call this adhesion, so make sure you write this down. Adhesion is the ability of water to bond to other substances. So this is how, if you just have a puddle of water and you place a paper towel on top, that's how the paper towel soaks up the water. Now, we have an actual term for how it does soak up that water, and that is called capillary action. Water molecules tow each other along when in a thin glass tube. They'll do it in plants, they do it in animals, they do it with your paper towel. There's all kinds of ways that water is able to use capillary action. So think about in a tree, you're trying to get water to the tip of the leaf from the root. It's just going to tow itself. So one molecule on top of another molecule on top of another molecule. So an example is transpiration process, which plants and trees remove water from the soil. And another would be when the paper towel soaks up the water. So there's all kinds of examples of this. Now, adhesion causes capillary action. Remember, adhesion is the ability of water to stick to something other than itself. You put this straw into the water and you suck it up. Yes, it's going to use a little bit of cohesion, but it's also going to use adhesion in accordance with the power that you are giving it. Another property of water is high specific heat. Specific heat is the amount of energy required to raise 1 gram of a substance 1 degree Celsius. Water has a higher specific heat than any other substances. This is why it takes a long time to heat water. And this is why our oceans generally stay at a pretty constant temperature. If you've been to the Atlantic coast in July, yes, it might be 95 degrees outside, but think of that huge body of water. It's going to take a lot of heat to heat that up, just 1 degree. Well, that is why when you go to the beach in July, the water may be cold, because we don't have enough heat to heat up that entire body of water. Lastly, ice floats. Now, this is due to the density of water, so you might want to write something down about density as well. When water becomes a solid at 0 degrees Celsius, so remember, 0 degrees is going to be its melting point and its freezing point, it floats because it is less dense than the liquid water. This is unique to water. So liquid water is more dense than the solid form of ice. This allows the oceans to stay at constant temperatures during the winter, and ice acts as an insulator for oceans, lakes, ponds. Now, this is why a lot of wildlife can live through the winter, because of the ability to have ice act as an insulator. Another property, not as important, is the high heat of vaporization. This has to do with the high specific heat. It's the amount of energy we use to convert 1 gram of a substance from a liquid to a gas. So we're vaporizing that water. In order for the water to evaporate, hydrogen bonds must be broken. So we're going to break those bonds in between those hydrogens and oxygens that are bonding it together, giving us that cohesion, giving us all of those properties As water evaporates, it removes a lot of heat with it. So the heat is going to make it evaporate, break those bonds, but we need a decent amount of heat to do this. So water vapor forms a kind of global blanket, which helps to keep the Earth warm. Water vapor is actually a greenhouse gas. Heat radiated from the sun warms the surface of the Earth and is absorbed and held by the vapor. Without some greenhouse gases, we would not be able to be warm. So water is something very good and very needed for the ability to keep our Earth at a constant warm temperature conducive to life. Lastly, we want to talk about the pH scale. The pH scale, you may have heard of, indicates an acid or a base. Now, what it actually measures is the percent of hydrogen ions. This is why it's called pH. P standing for percent, H standing for hydrogen. And we range from 0 to 14. Now, we have different numbers indicating different acids, bases. If you have a pH of 7, it's neutral. Not even water is generally neutral. Pure distilled water will be neutral. But most of the water you get out of the tap might be slightly basic or slightly acidic. Like a 7.1, 7.2, or like a 6.9, 6.8. It's not going to be far off from 7. pH from 0 to 7 is an acid. So you can have a 6 be an acid, or you can have a 1 being an acid. Now, what's the difference? The difference is the percent hydrogen that you have in there. And what's that going to do? Well, it's going to make it more acidic or more towards the neutral side. So the more acidic something is, the lower its pH is. So if you have a pH of 0.01, it's really, really, really acidic. Whereas if you have a pH of 6.9, it's almost neutral. So it is going to be different. Each of our pH units represents a factor of 10 times change in concentration. So if we go from a pH of 3 to a pH of 6, is 10 times 10 times 10 stronger, so 1,000 times stronger than a pH of 6. So keep that in mind. It's not just a change of one number. It's not going to be 3 times stronger. It's 1,000 times stronger. We're moving tenfold. Here's a little visualization of the pH scale. As you can see, very, very basic things are going to be near the top, so bleach, soapy water, ammonia. Those type of things are very, very basic. And if you get down to the bottom here by the very acidic side, you have your gastric acid, your stomach acid, lemon juice, and orange juice. And in the middle here, we have seawater, distilled water, and urine are all kind of around neutral. Now, that doesn't mean different things are going to necessarily fall at that number. It's all based on that hydrogen concentration. Now, they'll fall in and around the estimated number we have.